We released a documentary called Ancestral Voices, Esoteric African Knowledge. Now, well, yeah, there you go. Well, you have one of these posters. So that's a 5-6 year old poster, but this is when we first came out with the book. Do you mind if I take this to you? Please, thank you. Let me lift it up. Okay. So, this is, for those of you who may have come across it, this is a flyer for when we first released it, and listing some of the launch dates and the launch screenings. Yeah, so this is what the cover of the DVD also looks like. We released the film to open up a discussion about African spirituality. Because this is a topic that we find that often, the minute it comes up, a lot of people are against it. They can't actually list a particular reason why they're against it, but then they will quote for you colonial understandings of African spirituality and what it's supposed to be about. And it's usually two main words you hear. The first being is devil worship, or it's just superstition. Yes, there's nothing to it. It's nothing for you to have any respect for or even want to engage with, because it's supposed to be this backward primitive thing that, you know, Africans do. So what the film does is it compares ideas or tenets within mainstream religions, mainly the Abrahamic ones. So Judaism, Christianity, Islam, and even extends into Buddhism and Hinduism. So we look at these ideas as a way of comparing these systems and asking the question that, why do we think some of these other systems are, in a sense, more positive than the African system? Because if we consider that what we call human beings originated from Africa, then the very first discussions or even thoughts about this concept we call God would have started from there. So, you know, many scholars have spoken on it. We all know that what we call Christianity, yeah, the Abrahamic faith, have an African origin. Yes, over time they became whitewashed and they become, you know, a European kind of construct or an Arabic kind of construct. But within even the scriptures itself, you find many African ideas still there. So, for instance, one of the first things we looked at in the film is what people call ancestral veneration or ancestral communication within the African system. Now, we know, again, in the Abrahamic systems, you find it comes under the idea of honor your father and your mother. Yes? So, it's not as if they're so different. They're actually very similar. But again, when we look at why African spirituality has been stigmatized, you cannot really separate that from the way Africans socially are also disenfranchised, because it comes from the same idea. Yes? And the very first thing they try to do with Africans is, again, say, we're worshipping our ancestors. We don't have a God. So the very idea of a God is the highest expression in any community or culture. Yes? Because this is how you see yourself as, should we say, superhuman. So if someone's telling you you don't have a God, and they can give you a God that looks like them, eventually you will start to worship them.
Right.
And we see this in many of the ways that so-called black people behave. You know, I'm sure if I went to any country in Africa now, or we went somewhere in the Caribbean, you know, me and a white person step off the plane, we have probably the same amount of money in our pocket.
Yeah.
The other African person will run and carry the white person's bag and leave mine. So we have this kind of psychological dysfunction that is infused in our minds through the religion. Because again, as I said, the idea of religion and the concept of God is you looking for a higher self to yourself. So if you think you don't have any higher self, and someone has shown you, oh, this is the higher self, then that's what you're going to respect. You won't respect yourself. So over and over again, because we've had a lot of opposition to this work, Because for some people, they cannot find a way to debate us into saying what we're putting forward is wrong. Yes, so they rather resort to kind of like attacks and, you know, what they call it now, shame. You know, they try and pretend that, oh yeah, these people don't know what they're talking about. But we quote our words, we put it into reference. So this is not my opinion I'm telling you, this is a fact. Right, now, moving on from ancestral voices, one, esoteric knowledge, we've spent the last 5 years trying to make the second film. We've conducted two crowdfunding campaigns, none of which have hit the target, but we've still persevered because we know the work is necessary. Because you see, we can do everything we want, but if we cannot show that, again, we believe in the wisdom of our own ancestors in creating this God concept, because again, it comes, as I've said, from Africa.
Right.
Yes? So if we cannot show that we're proud of that, I personally don't think there's anything that we can do, whether it's socially, economically, that really will push us forward. Because we think a lot of everything we're doing now is social and it's whatnot, but everything is rooted in a spiritual base. Yes? So when you're leaving your own spiritual base, you can try all the things that this man-made system has given you. You cannot go forward. Because again, and I'm going to touch on this when I come closer, you see, what Africans already understood for however many millions of years we've been around is your ancestors exist within you. Remember, if your ancestors never had their unions over time, you wouldn't be here. It's not Jesus that brought us here, and it's not Muhammad either. Yes, it's your ancestors. Remember, Jesus and Muhammad were born into families too. So they are also somebody's ancestor. So if you are now constantly praying to them and giving them all this psychic energy and force, you're making them powerful, not yourself. Because really what you're showing is you don't respect yourself.
Right.
So when we're talking about how we want to be treated respectfully and Black Lives Matter, how can it all matter if you don't respect your own self? Yeah, it sounds simple, but again, as I said, I've had many debates. And you find how people run and pick excuses, and they tell you all kinds of stories. So I've kind of gone beyond that. We don't want to keep having a debate that involves these Abrahamic traditions.
Yeah.
We've had millions of years where our history is totally lost. We don't really need to, we don't even really know ourselves that much. So our focus should be on finding ourselves. And again, this is where African spirituality becomes important, because it's not really this idea that you're looking for this God up there. And again, as I said, there's no God or person up there that's coming to save you. What African spirituality in essence deal with is your discovery of yourself, your ability, your potential, and how to manifest those possibilities. Yes, this is what they might say, oh, that ritual and his juju, and they did this to me, and you know, this person did this to me, and I got sick, and I did X, Y, Z. It's all witchcraft. But again, what do we mean by this so-called witchcraft? In a sense, witchcraft is the ability for someone to get you to do what you didn't want to do. They can enforce their will on you. Now, if you look at, you know, I'll use the TV as an example, where you never had an idea you wanted to buy, I don't know, some Gucci bag or some Versace bag. You sat down, you watched this advert, it made you feel to want that bag. Next minute, the next day, you stood up, took your hard-earned money, and went and bought the bag. That is witchcraft. It's a clear example of it. But again, when I have these conversations, again, it's like you're looking for this, some African devil with out.
Yeah,
so again, it's what I'm telling you, the psychology is so deep that we need to actually do some deep study of ourselves and how we've now become something different to ourselves. Yes? That's our way forward. If we keep going in this conversation of, oh, let's pick this verse and show how the verse is wrong, and then the Christian would then turn around and tell you, but how about the rest of the Bible? We're wasting time.
That's right.
We need our time to focus on self.
Yes.
Because once you're focusing on self and you're doing all the rituals necessary to remember, yes, because I'll come back to this, in that DNA, because it's funny how science is now proving what
they were calling superstition yesterday. I'll get to that in a minute. So if we get into these rituals, yes, and come into this understanding that we already know, but in a sense we've forgotten, because African spirituality deals with the process of remembrance. Yes, it's you remembering what your ancestors put forth for you to carry forward. Okay, so I'll repeat that again. We're not necessarily looking for a being in the sky, but we're looking for how to manifest our greatest self. Okay, so we did 5 years of crowdfunding. We managed to raise some money. We traveled to South Africa, we traveled to Brazil, we traveled to Haiti and to the United States, where we interviewed a range of academic scholars as well as practitioners, you know. Sanderos, Mambos, which are like Haitian traditional healers and spiritualists, so that we can get a clear picture. Because often when we hear these conversations on African spirituality, they say, oh yeah, these Pan-Africans, and they're just idolizing Africa, trying to pretend Africa is this one big thing. There's all this diversity there. It doesn't exist, it's an illusion. However, in doing our research, it's not even something that we had to do research to know, but we did the research to prove to those who are doubting. Because again, the other thing that we come across when you look at black, don't like using that word, but sometimes that's the only thing that fits easily in the commentary, so I have to use it. When we deal with kind of like black scholarship and what black folk do, is we have this mistrust of ourselves where we think, but if I haven't been able to do it, who do you think you are that you came up across this research? How can you know more than I know? When we're all in the same, in a sense, social situation. So we ourselves doubt our own scholarship. Yeah, we prefer to see a European man and preferably a non-white folk, maybe wearing glasses, because it makes him look intelligent, then we believe that. So, fast forward. We didn't let the crowdfunding stop us. We went to those areas. We got the evidence that we needed. And the evidence just doesn't stop in contemporary times. Because you see, we've been able to trace since the time of the ancient black Egyptians and the spiritual philosophy that underpinned the way they built their societies. We've been able to show very clearly that it's the very same that you find today in, let's say, Ifa cosmology, Akan, the Dogon, the Bakongo, and we're looking at the Bantu people who stretch from all the way from east to central down to southern Africa. And we've gone to southern Africa to speak to the highest, they're called Sangomas. He's the highest Anusi. You might know him, he goes by the name of Credo Mutwa. Yes? So if we're able to show that what Africans are doing in contemporary times now, to however tens of thousands of years ago they were doing, the question we need to ask is, how do they remember this? Because remember, there are no African Bibles we can go and find with the do's and the don'ts. Yes? And even more importantly, after 500-600 years of separation between Africans in, you know, what we might now call the Caribbean, we find the very same system, the same philosophical ideas, the same ritual practices still existed. After however they cut off people from their culture, their names, their identity, all of that, but we find the spiritual expression is still there. So what is it about this that you can't kill? Because you cannot kill spirit. Yes, what we call spirit, or in a sense your mind, your consciousness. You know, you can do whatever you want to the body, but the spirit is still there. So from the time of the ancient Egyptians to now on the continent into the diaspora, we find the same, that process of remembrance. Now, you might ask, why is this necessary? You know, we can see all the problems so-called religion is causing around the world. You know, there's fights here, there's fights there. Modern science is now coming up with a lot of, I'll say funny ideas, because it's something that personally I feel they've always known. But then to discredit the African, they made it, as I said earlier, seem like superstition. But now they're coming forward with it as scientific discoveries. And I'll give you one of the very first ones, which is the most important, because I'll draw it back to when I twice said about the ancestors. They now have something called chromosomic memory. Yes? And what chromosome memory deals with is the fact that the Western scientists are saying that they've discovered that in your DNA are all the traits. So you see, when you think, oh, I have a fear of spiders, or I'm an extrovert, and you think this is something that you, it's you. These things are transmitted from your ancestors. And so we're talking about however long you can go back. All this information is encoded there. Yes, you have the Emory University School of Medicine. They came out with that, should we say, conclusion in 2013. But the Russian Academy of Sciences have been working on it for over 10 years. Yeah, they go down to something they call epigenetics. So if they are telling you that all of what you are comes from your ancestors, but then the first European invaders were being told by Africans that they could communicate with their ancestors from then. Mm-hmm. So yesterday's superstition, now we're being asked to accept it as fact, only because it's coming from who? The European. Mm-hmm. So are we still going to carry on with this? Let's wait for them to tell us what we already know. Mm-hmm. Or are we going to be the vanguards? Because we're closer to the culture. It doesn't matter that you think you're not from an African country. This memory already exists in you. Hmm. Yes, it's in there. But because you're not engaging in the practices, mm-hmm. you know, however many a libation you might pour a week. Mm-hmm. Yes, when you're going into ritual now, as it indicates, ritual has to be a continuous process. Yeah. It's something you do over time. You don't think you pour a libation today, all your problems solved. Done. You can come back 2 years later. Mm-hmm. You put it into ritual. That means it becomes a cycle. Yeah, look at life. Life is based on cycles. We're back in autumn now. Soon we'll be in winter. Then we go to spring, and it repeats year in, year out. So if you're kind of really serious about bringing forth this best in you, you're going to have to do the work. It's not going to take a week, a month, a year. It might take even longer than that. But what you will realize is, over time, you're becoming. And you'll notice it. You'll be surprised some of the interactions you have and how enriched it's become and how much more you have of an understanding of everything that happens to you. Yes? Because you're your own teacher. You're your own God. Yes? This is why we have one of the African conceptions of God or the creator is that source is our first ancestor. Yeah? Because however long back we can go, that's where we end up. That's just one of them. The second quite prominent one is that God or the creator is a female. And because the African doesn't look at this idea as a person, yes, it's an immaterial form, yes, and it's also a function, because what they realize that what we can call God now is a process of creation. Yeah, and it's a man cannot create on his own. Yes, so that's why we have the very first depiction of God is called Ta'et, and it's a pregnant hippopotamus. And it's not a hippopotamus that's supposed to be God, it's that process of birthing the child. Yes, and again, when we look into the Asian Egyptian cosmology, when the male god Amen-Ra came into being, when he became physical form, he says in his own words that he came from his mother Nun, and Nun is the primordial water. Nun has no form. So again, you see where the female is placed in the cosmology. Yes? So, coming back to the journey for the book, after the, you know, crowdfunding campaign, we're still at an impasse. We haven't raised the money needed to finish the film. So then we looked at our research. We have about 50 books that we've read, brought ideas to show the premise of what we're trying to prove. And we decided to put all of that research into a book form as another incentive to raise money to complete the film. Yes, because the film looks at African spirituality as a complete system. Yes, we're looking at what are the African conceptions of God. We're looking at African ideas about the person. How do Africans look at you the person, how did you come about? Yes, we're looking at, again, ritual, because I just didn't want this book to become an intellectual exercise. Mm. We have to be able to give you information that is practical and useful to how you live your life, mm. because this is how the process of remembrance occurs. Mm. I'll give you a very useful example. There's a man by the name of George Washington Carver. Mm-hmm. Yeah? He is officially one of the most prolific chemists and inventors in the 20th century. An enslaved African, but this man managed his prowess in agricultural science far exceeded anybody of his time. Mm-hmm. At a time when black people could barely travel, the Royal Academy of Science Arts here had already made him an honorary member. He met three American presidents, and when he died, they put him on a stamp. Now, George Washington Carver had a, he said his inventions came to him.
Yeah.
Listen to how it came to him. He would wake up at dawn and walk into nature. And he said when he walked into nature, the plants spoke to him. Mm. Is this something you would hear any scientist say? Because science is supposed to be based on rationality, logic, empiricism. Mm. Yeah, there's no room for this. What do you mean? I can't hear the language of plants. Mm. How did the plants speak to you? But you see, the funny thing is, it's an established practice among African shamans. They wake up at dawn, and this is how they find out about the curative and medicinal abilities of plants. It's already on it. It's something they do naturally. So how did Carver know this? He's been carved from Africa for over 500 years. But it came to him. And again, I take you back to what I just said. What science is now calling chromosomic memory. Or genetic memory. So within each and every one of us exists that knowledge. But perhaps we are not aware of it because the practices that help us remember, we're not using it. Yeah? Okay, so moving forward now, I'll give you a brief reading of what the book is about, because there's so much information here. If I just pick a bit, I'm going to lose you. So let me read the whole back, and then maybe I'll read a bit of the foreword by Robin Walker himself. Because I approached Robin because from reading Robin's book, I can tell I work in academia. Robin also has a background in academia. So I know he would push me to make sure that I'm not pushing forward something that can be discounted as it's your opinion, you know, you're a practitioner, so you're trying to push your own what you want forward. And he gave me that check. I went through many iterations of the book for him to say, okay, you know what? That is valuable. You substantiated that point.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. That's right. So for me, for him to get up and then put the foreword, I knew that we've arrived at a good place. Oh, I know, and I respect him very much for that.
Yes.
It's the film that we made together. Yeah, the book, I took the lead on that. You know, we have two children, so we can't always do everything. All practically under 6 years old, so we have to learn what best works for both of us. Yeah. So I'll give you the reading. It says here, this book is a groundbreaking exploration of man's oldest documented faith practice, African spirituality, a term often criticized for assuming homogeneity in African philosophy and culture that apparently does not exist. However, these research findings reveal intricate and broad commonalities across the various systems that clearly evidence a high level of unison in the cosmological philosophies and practices of African people. The author explores the topic across millennia, from the times of the ancient Black Egyptians to contemporary practices on the continent and in the diaspora. Evidenced are striking commonalities in the spiritual philosophies and practices over time and space, showing they are derived from a common mind or source. That what we term Vodou, Vodun, Ifa, Candomblé, Payomayombe, Kemetic spirituality, and the like are all but localized offshoots of the same tree, so to speak. As such, African spirituality is shown to be an apt umbrella for the various expressions the world over, one that will give its adherents official recognition and rights in the same manner various sects within mainstream religions are protected by law. Mm. This book also gives practical advice and suggestions from various systems on how to cultivate an African-centered spiritual life. So it's not just an essential piece of scholarly work to read, but also an invaluable manual of instruction to have for cultivating one's own personal spiritual development. So in the outlook for the book and the film, as and when we can get it out, we, you know, there are many books written on African spirituality, right? But you find them, maybe it will be about the Yoruba, it will be about the Akan, mm-hmm. It will be about the Zulus, mm-hmm. right? And for us, where that problem, or the problem it created was that it breaks Africa into the segments that allows much of the division that we all know, I can say I'm African, you know, you might say you're Caribbean, then there's these certain bits that keep us, yes, from a certain level of just connecting. So we wanted to make sure that the work that we're bringing forth brings a complete picture. And again, as I said, I use George Carver as one example, but I could list many others. So it's not just Africans who can experience these things. And when I say Africans, you know, let's just say, it's not just continental Africans.
Thank you.
Yeah, those who might be so close to their culture because you live in a country that has a European label as the name. Mm-hmm. It's not as simple as that. Because I've met, personally, some psychics in this country from a Caribbean background who can do so much more than Babalawos I know who've been trained 40 odd years. So this is not, it's not stuck to a tradition only. Again, as I said, it's in here. But you need to bring it forward with the practices that you engage in, you know? So Robin likes to call it the first Pan-African book on spirituality, you know? I'll take that gladly. That essentially is what the book entails. Yeah, so as I said, we do the intellectual stuff. We look at the conceptions of God. God as a female, God as a male-female pair, which is really only talking about the principle of balance, yeah, equilibrium. We look at God.
Sorry? Maat.
Yes, Maat, there you go, you know. We also look at God as energy and consciousness, which really is the key that underlines what we call ritual. Yes, because the African worldview is not you're just a physical container, what we call the body. Mm-hmm. It actually has to do with energy and vibration. Mm-hmm. Yes, and we know this to have importance because you can have someone who's singing, yes, and they can raise their pitch to such a high tone, it will shatter all the glass that we have in here. How does frequency affect matter? And when we look in the African tradition again, you see two ideas for you, the person. You have this physical body, but you also have what we call a spirit. And that spirit is that consciousness that comes from God, right? So the real you is not the body, it's the consciousness. Yes? Because that consciousness can take any vessel. And again, this is why you can then also, as the human being, also connect with virtually anything. Because everything has a form of or frequency that it emanates. So if you know and you put yourself in that state, you will see just how clear cut that communication can be. Yeah. So that is some of the topics covered in here, and I will more than happily take any questions. I don't want to ramble on, but I can do that too.
You're not rambling.
Okay.
Yes. So yes, but yeah. What do you think of the mixed race people there? Because I understand your perspective of the African and the heritage, but if white people must also have a lineage, so if you're mixed race, then you're going to have two lines of genetic information.
Possibly.
And would they clash with each other? Because
how will it clash with each other if all comes from the source?
Well, the European mm-hmm. way of looking yeah. appears to be clashing with the African because of his slavery and so on and
of
so
course.
On. So those very Europeans mm-hmm. that have enslaved Africans, they have a genetic history also.
Mm-hmm.
So their genetic history,
mm-hmm.
from what you said, mm-hmm. told them to come back and enslave the Africans.
It's a wide question, it's a very relevant question, but I'm going to have to break it apart because one of the things that we have to understand is, let's not let our social understandings always tar everything else. How did the European come into being? If they did not meet the physical African first. Remember, what we know of the European is a mixture between Africans and what was it, a man-like creature that we now term the Neanderthal. This is how Africans and Europeans came to be, from the research I've come across and can be collaborated with what you're now saying that only Africans don't have the Neanderthal DNA, but everybody else has that DNA.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so yes, there is a kind of mixture of DNA. But then to understand the European even further, you have to look at some of the works of people like Michael Bradley, The Iceman Inheritance,
mm-hmm.
where they look at how the environment can also change your thinking.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're coming from a place where you can hardly find any food, you think everything is in a state of scarcity. So again, if you look at how the factories operate, they can produce however many, let's say, Mars bars a year. That go to waste.
Yeah.
But because you're thinking that, okay, this thing is about to run out, I constantly need to bring it, you're even overproducing stuff you don't need.
Right. Okay.
Yes, but if you're living in a place where you wake up in the morning, you're like, okay, I'm hungry, I'll get that mango from the trees right there.
Right.
It's free. I don't have to pay for it. There's no scarcity. You arrive at a different understanding of yourself than someone who has to break how many feet of ice just to get one fish to share with everybody else.
Right. Okay.
You understand? So for me, this is where it comes in. In a sense, over time, they've developed a certain consciousness. But that consciousness is mainly to hold social superiority. To get that my book is where I've been waiting for, you know, it even makes me a bit shaky. I've added to the conversation, and hopefully if it can, then yes, indeed. And I agree with you with the terms that we use, you know, and again, it's where sometimes you want to say something, but then you put that in there and it kind of extends your idea and you don't really want that. So as much as we try and book, we use the word creator. But
right.
Sometimes where to put that in, it becomes a bit tricky, you know, because again, if you're a creator, you're making. Yes, it's what's coming forth.
Mm-hmm.
So this is why we can have male and a female pair as one of the very conceptions that we have. Because it's a man and a woman that come together to make.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you look at the Shona, dear conception of God, Tendai Mwari, which most of you know, is a man, a woman, and child.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, in Christianity we have that now is a man and a woman in the spirit. Oh, well, sorry, it's actually a man. Yes. So, again, you're right. The God, you use the word God, people have an image of a person.
Mm.
But then when we're saying creator now, we expand your consciousness. And really, that's where we should aim for, expanding that consciousness. So people can extend their thinking of things and how they understand it too. You know, with the word the black and the white, yes, I do agree. For me, what I've seen is we haven't understood able to use it as well as we should for our own benefit.
Mm.
Because once you use black now, the Asian man can come and sit on the side,
exactly.
The Chinese man sits on there.
Mm-hmm.
And because the system kind of already doesn't want the African black to really progress.
That's right.
They find ways that they can use that word against. However many unemployment tribunals I've been privy to, because I do a lot of union work as well, where they'll say, the person is black and was the only one being targeted. But then they'll bring forth, but she's black and she's Asian.
That's right.
Yes. So with that, they can defeat many an argument. So for me, again, if we can start to use these words to the best of our benefit,
yes,
really, it then won't matter at all.
Mm.
But that's not what I'm seeing. What I'm seeing is it's being used against us.
Mm.
Yes, so there'll be a Asian Resource Center. That's allowed.
That's right.
Yeah, but then the minute you put the black there,
what?
That Asian can still come and take the money and put it in the Asian Resource Center, and you, the black African, can't go to that
center. That's right.
So we have to really start getting into how we use those words for our benefit, because you know, the same thing that can be used positively can also be used negatively. As you said, the two sides of the coin.
Yes.
It's the same thing. So for me, if we're going to use anything, we just have to understand A, how we can use it to our advantage, and B, how we can make sure it doesn't get used against us. They have the means, you know, forcibly to do that. So again, as I said, we have a big challenge. You know, we have a big challenge, and for me, I strongly urge, and for people first, that work has to start with you, the individual. Because you see, when you're doing that work, you, again, repeating that same point, you'll be surprised how things come. Because I'll give you South Africa as an example. I didn't know where to find Kwesi Mutua, because they've tried to kill him so many times. So he moved somewhere close to the Kalahari Desert. It took us a good 10 hours to get to where he was. Yeah, and even have someone just came and sent us a quick message, you know, if you want to see him, I can show you where he is. It's like some kind of top MI5 type operation.
That's right.
He's trying to make it film. You know, but again, this is what shows you that where we have centers of power, these guys are always and ever ready, because
that's right,
they're using for their power, whether we know it or not.
Yeah.
This is why, you know, they'll change identities and how many were rappers, big change, whatnot. You know, they'll give us all these funny ideas about ourselves. And to again come back to the point where I said that when you do that work, you will then start to see less of this separation, right? Kwesi Mutua, he's quite well traveled, been around the world, been many places, quite well known. Brazil, I interviewed this Santero. Never been to school, could hardly speak the Portuguese properly himself. But how does this Santero know exactly the same conceptions as Kwesi Mutua in Africa? The man's never left Brazil. He knew the exact same thing. So this is what I'm saying again. First do the work here, because then those who are there that are on that level with you, you will connect with them physically. Because again, as I said, one of the conceptions being the creator is energy and consciousness. And if you really start to do these works that elevate what we call your life force, or again, your spirit, you will find that those that are on that same energy, should we say, band with you, they will come to you. You will find them too. I've seen it with every place we've been. You know, people who've come to help us and send us places. Yeah? So, my brother, you?
You let him go.
Okay,
I've got a question. When you say ancestral memory, or DNA memory,
yes.
But isn't it a fact in the tariff? Well, let me ask the question. Yeah. Right. Let me see it. Is the memory of the spiritual rituals the handing down from parent to child, maybe like in a secret society or something?
Yes.
Is that an aspect of it, rather than we intuit it?
Yes.
Also, I remember probably 16 or 20 years ago, the Europeans were saying something that is learned thousands of years ago is transmitted to the rest of humanity, that when you come to learn it, it becomes easy, as if they said, oh, I've done this thing before.
Okay.
I know they said there's that kind of science, yeah? Because they had an example with, they trained a group of apes, in Africa, to do one thing, yeah? And then they wanted to see if this ape would transmit it to its group, right? But they found that in another group, unassociated, that when they introduced that thing, that those groups were starting to do the thing quicker than the original group. Now, I don't know what's going on there, Yeah, I don't know. But I'm wondering, from the original thing what you're saying, it's in the DNA. I truly believe in the DNA, in the sense that when we are coming to, like, I can't remember who said it, but somebody said, why is it that Africans, when we come to do certain skills, we're quick at it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Yes.
I've noticed, yes, when we come to do, I've noticed it in electronics and electrical, yeah? But this person was speaking in terms of brickwork.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
He said, our African students are quick to do brickwork, yeah? And I said, because our ancestors did it so many thousands of years ago. Yes. This thing was second nature. Uh-huh. We don't have to go to school to do it.
Yes.
To
yes.
us, we look at it and we say, I figure it out.
Yeah.
And we got it.
That's right.
But with the ritual side, uh-huh, I want to know, is that intuition,
mm-hmm,
mainly intuition,
mm-hmm,
or mainly that we perfected our rituals, mm-hmm, and we secretly had to hand it down on the pen of death?
Yes. Okay, Tindamaya, thank you very much for your point. And there are two points you said. Is it learned behavior or experience,
mm,
or if it's strictly intuition?
Mm.
I would say it's both. Yes, there's aspects of both involved. And I already gave the example of Washington Carver.
Mm.
Washington Carver was a Christian. As an enslaved, they couldn't be anything else.
Mm.
Yes, and he actually said all the things he was inventing was coming from Jesus Christ. It's one of his pronouncements. At the same time, it's coming from Jesus Christ, but he's walking in nature like an African shaman.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? So again, you see that our systems don't, they're not exclusive, like the Abrahamic religions, which pretend, you know, if you're not following my Ten Commandments, yeah, it's not. Because again, everything is the creator. We just have individualized consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the basic foundations, but the book first shows you some foundations within African thought, that then shows you how it affects the spirituality. One of them is the interconnectedness of all things.
Mm.
Yes, because all nothing is separate.
Yeah.
Everything relates to the other, mm, in one way, shape, or form. And in an Akan proverb, it says, "Nipa baku no kunu osunu ena mansi nyani." What this means is it takes one person to kill an elephant and the whole universe to consume it. Yes? It took the Europeans to the 60s to develop this theory called the butterfly effect,
yes,
which is that if a butterfly flaps its wings, let's say in Singapore, it can create a typhoon somewhere in the Americas.
Yes.
Yeah? So again, we have this interconnectedness of things where
they're now using that in science.
Again, so this is what I'm saying, that you see, it's such a shame that, and I feel it, I know we must all feel it, we've been pushed down to such a degree that even trying to believe in ourselves becomes a problem.
Yes.
Yeah? So this is, and I come across it time and time again, even yesterday when we had the presentation that we had, you could see it. It's like, I'm telling people, okay, look, you can go, just try it. And you can see that, like, I should think this guy is making it sound easy, and it's not. Because using myself as an example, at a time when my grandma passed and I was just at home, because, you know, in coming into, as to why we started doing the films, again, you start to see where and how I got here. Yeah, so there was a time when I was at home, most of the time, because I just finished the O-level, everyone was going to work, and I was just in the house. I had to do the cooking and the cleaning and everything to make sure when the rest of the family comes home. And I just kept getting this direction that I could speak to my grandma who passed. We're born on the same day, share the same name, so they named me after it. And at the time, raised in a Catholic home, all I knew was a Christian mass ritual, yes? And I'd been reading quite a lot of this kind of self-help psychology type books. So I knew something told me, you know, you light a candle. The only thing I had was a rosary. So apart from the rosary, I would also write her name down and speak her name. And, you know, pour some little water, because I'd seen that too in the traditional celebration. And I'll tell you what, in what I was, the conversations I was having with her, some things came to me as to where I would be in a year or two. The next year I was here at the College of Northwest London. And this is how my journeys began. Because even when I was at the College of Northwest London, I wanted, because I was doing media and communication, I wanted to make a film about the Asante spiritual traditions.
And for some reason, I was scared, and I was like, I'm not going to do that, because nobody's going to talk to me after that, you know? Forget it. So I left it for over 10 years until I met my wife. And then again, through our own conversations, we said, you know what, okay, let's revisit this again. And this time, I don't want to just do an Asante one. Let's look at what exactly this thing is. And this is what has grown and become that. So yes, there is, I would say, those two ideas. One, learned experience that is remembered, and then two, also within. But within, you need to have an element of confidence in yourself that you are capable, that it will come, that you will have the patience to see it manifest. Yeah. But if you're in a hurry thinking, I'll do it 1 week and big result, then you're in a sense you're not ready. You're not ready. I mean, I said the film has taken a good 15 years for me to get to this point. So it's that growth, you know? So we have to give ourselves time. But most importantly, we cannot lose confidence in our ability to be able to do it eventually. So thank you very much for your question.
Okay.
African spirituality is shown to be an apt umbrella for the various expressions the world over, one that will give its adherents official recognition and rights. In the same manner, various sects within mainstream religions are protected by law. Yes, in Brazil, candomblé, it used to be decriminalized, but now it's legal. Voodoo, as we know it, in Benin, is a national religion. Mm-hmm. You know, to register something as a religion, even though it might be inadequate, as I was telling the brother there, we have to understand the different, should we say, spheres that make up what we call society. There's a social one, there's a religious one, there's a psychological one. So again, this is, we need to learn how to, in a sense, politicize it. And I said, anyone who gets into the traditions at some point will realize that we can't make it a religion. But in the reality we're living now, we have to use the tools that are being used, whether against or for us, and use the same for that liberation process. So if we can group it all under one umbrella, because they all have specific themes, tenets, as the book has covered, then that can put a case forward and have it listed in the same way as Hinduism and Buddhism also came to be listed post the Beatles and whatnot. Because once upon a time, that was also devil worship. They used to call it the same thing. Mm. You know, so yes, we can. But if we keep going along the lines of that's Vodou, mine is Ifa, mine is Umbanda, mine is this. Where is the connection? Yeah, so a candomblé practitioner will get protected to a degree, even they still get murdered. Every year, there's at least 10 priests killed off by evangelical Christians, and the government doesn't do anything. Even there where it's protected by law. So yeah, we can. I'm in talks with, you know, Brother Diza, who is now a Mami Wata initiate, and hence why, you know, the brother, when he introduced it, he said this is a Mami Wata temple as well. I've been speaking to him for the last 5 years, where we've been looking at ways in which we can institutionalize some of what we're doing. So we can, yeah, we can get some due process to work for us too. Because in some places, anyone knows you do this kind of stuff, you're dead. Mm. And nothing will happen about it. Because the policeman who come to investigate will look at you and be like, ah, thank God, the devil's gone. Now we can get back to living. Yeah, so we have to use the political tool. And Master said, hopefully, or rather, if we're willing, we will make it happen. Yeah, so it'll take time, but it's getting there. Yeah.
When we information back, spend some time reading the book.
If you would want. Despite the interest that people of African heritage have in the spiritual realm, there are surprisingly few books that have so far been written that give an overview of the indigenous African spiritual heritage and its dispersal to the African diaspora.
This book, Ancestral Voice, The Spirit is Eternal, is one of those few exceptions. At once scholarly, but very simply written, this book deserves a place in every home. Scholars and teachers have written and taught learnedly on African religion, including Professor John Jackson, Professor Joseph Ben Yochanan, Professor Charles Finch, and Ashraf Kwesi. However, their works largely demonstrated the African influence on the Abrahamic religions. They did not discuss the African heritage itself in any particular detail. Other writers presented detailed accounts of the spiritual systems of their own locality in Africa, but did not attempt to connect and synthesize their knowledge with the other African spiritual systems to tell any big narrative. Professor John Mbiti was the only exception. He attempted to join the dots and present African spiritual systems in a comprehensive and coherent manner. Consequently, he dominated the scholarly arena on the African spiritual heritage from 1969 until now. His African Religions and Philosophy is a classic. The new book, Ancestral Voice, The Spirit is Eternal, is therefore a welcome addition to this field. It builds upon the skeleton created by Professor Mbiti, but adds much meat onto that skeleton. The author draws upon and synthesizes much more recent research that was then unavailable to Professor Mbiti. Moreover, the book includes some of the traditional spiritual systems practiced in the African diaspora. Again, this is a welcome advance on Mbiti. Ancestral Voices, Spirit is Eternal provides a practical and relevant understanding of African spiritual systems, showing their commonalities in ideas and practices from all over Africa and its diaspora. The author details the richness and the sophistication of the spiritual systems, proving that they are in no way inferior to the Abrahamic and other spiritual systems. The book also provides relevant details to show the difference between the spiritual systems, and the author is careful not to present these different systems as a homogenized whole. The book thus provides an excellent starting point for people who want to engage with and embrace this ancient heritage. This is a particularly crucial issue since more and more people are seeing the holes in the Abrahamic religious heritage and wish to go deeper. In writing the book, the author confronts the racist and religious bigotry that unfortunately still dominates the discourse surrounding African spiritual systems. Despite living in a so-called secularized age, misinformation dating from the colonial era and their missionary agents still dominate the field. This misinformation is the biggest single reason why so many black people today are ashamed of their African spiritual heritage. This book could not have come at a more opportune time. As most of the West is becoming more and more secular, with an anything goes mentality, Christian Zionism is dominating Christianity in America on one hand, and by right-wing anti-government Second Amendment Christianity on the other. Elsewhere, Wahhabi Islam is on the rise and spreading like wildfire. These hardline religious traditions are influencing black people all over the world, especially those who have not done their due diligence. The big question you should be asking in this confused and conflicted era is, what are the African spiritual systems about? What are they saying? This book answers those questions. Robin Walker.
Yeah.
So that's the foreword there. I'm going to list the chapters and what that creates, and if you want me to read a bit from there too, I can do that. So in chapter one, we look at the African spiritual universe and cosmology. We look at the African viewpoint of the nature of existence, order and balance, the interconnectedness of things, social and spiritual hierarchy, cyclical existence, spirit of being. Then we look at the African conceptions of the creator, or what we call, know mainly as God. So we look at the creator as nature, the creator as female, as male and energy pair, as spirit energy and consciousness, and as ancestor. In chapter 2, we look at nature and its forces, the natural forces, you know, what people call Onisha, Aboso, Nkisi, Neteru, Neter. We look at what the natural forces are, and we look at them most importantly as agents of social and personal development. Because one of the main misunderstandings when people look at these things is, you know, they call them African gods. But when you get deep in the tradition, you realize we're not talking about gods. We're talking about principles for living. And these principles, again, you find all within your body system and processes. You know, so you have so much water in your body which can get affected when you have a full moon. Why? We're dealing with the principle of Yemoja. But then, you know, you might think, oh, Yemoja is just a woman that lives in the sea. So, you know, we keep going to the sea. But you've not understood how, what does that have to do with you in terms of the amount of water content in your body. So we kind of want to leave the superficial explanations and let people get what their understanding is really supposed to be. So that's that chapter. Then we look at the nature of humanity and purpose. We look at humanity as a spirit being, destiny and divine purpose. We look at dreams and then divination. Then we look at the ancestors. We look at why some ancestors become deified, or, you know, given, should we say, creator-like status. Then we look at how to communicate with ancestors. Then in chapter 5, we look at the African forms of veneration. We look at African prayers, shrines and altars, sacrifices, libation, offerings, singing, drumming, meditation, and yoga as well. I can read a section on that, because when I read meditation and yoga. So I can read that there if you want. Rituals for living. We look at rituals. How do you live with rituals? We look at communal rituals, individual rituals, aspects of a ritual, and then what people say is witchcraft or sorcery. What really are they saying then? Then the final chapter looks at recognition and respect. How do we now put this forward so we get that respect that really we deserve and don't have to be begging or asking for? So that's basically the book. It looks small, but there's a lot in here. I can guarantee you that. Yeah. So, yes. Because it will slip me soon. Mm-hmm. You know, daddy brain is going on at the moment. So easily, So the last question was the spiritual cowardice. You see, I think.
Well, that wasn't a question. That was
it was part of.
Yeah.
And what was the question following that?
No. That bit was the. I said, have you interacted with
yes, okay,
Afrikaner, mm-hmm, and the people who's following?
Yes.
Or dear to.
Okay. Yes.
Abrahamic.
Okay.
Yeah.
You see, the thing is, Afrikaner, when I got to Ghana, because I knew about them through Shakara, actually. I think there was an article in one of the newspapers. So where I went to in Ghana, or thought there was a base, it wasn't, because they'd moved a bit more into, should we say, the center of Accra.
Okay. Yeah.
I went to look for them in the airport, and they had the land, but it said, you know, don't come near the land. So I thought they did actually just left. So yeah. No, I missed the opportunity. But no, Hebrew Israelites, no. You see, because I've had some interactions with Hebrew Israelites unrelated to the web. And for me, I find it sad when I hear or see another person with the same hue, you know, it doesn't even look European as yet, telling me that because I'm darker than them, I'm supposed to be the son of Ham. Now, you see, this is where the conflict, and this what shows how we have a psychosis going on. On the one hand, you want us to believe that the European is all evil and destructive, but you can't get away from the one book that is the sole source of our subservience. So you know, whenever I come across any group, and you know, you can say all the highest and nicest principles you want, but then you bring it back to a collection of different people's words that you're now claiming is the word of God. I can't take you serious beyond a certain point, because your very foundation, perhaps it's why you don't understand yourself. Mm-hmm. So you can tell me anything you want, and you can tell me about this principle, that principle, and what does this do to the body, but then you come back and you're telling me that we can have a moon, a sun, that are able to know how to go in cycles. They know when to form, what's it called again? Eclipses, mm-hmm. create all these things. And these beings, these entities don't need a book to guide what they've been doing for millennia. But we who are supposedly the most intelligent need a book that, you know, God is so powerful to make all these things, sorry, the creator, but we need a book on how to behave.
Why don't you talk to us, Derek?
Why not?
Why not?
In our consciousness, if those big planetary bodies have a inbuilt intelligence to know what to do, what do we need a book? From birth, in Akan, we have a proverb. This means no one teaches a child about the creator. Because you come into so Oludumari is the same as Amen Ra and Nun. But Amen Ra and Nun refer to the same concept as Oludumari, which is the supreme creator. Yes? Nyankopon will fit under that too. I'll use our skeletons as an example because it goes back to the brother here. You look different to me physically, don't you? Yeah? But when we shed off the flesh, what do you have there? It's the one thing. That is the unison. Your skeleton is the framework that you build ideas on. So what this book looks at is the skeleton. Because that skeleton is a set of ideas and principles. And so what I do is, rather than going to focus on, oh, the name is Oludumari, again, as I said, we know the Yorubas know Oludumari, the Asian Kemetians knew Amen Ra, Nun. Yes? Concept. Because you see, look, this is shoes, yes?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Shoes are the concept. Are you wearing boots? Is that not an example of shoes? Mm-hmm. Are you wearing sandals, my brother? Is that not an example of shoes? Mm-hmm. So, once we start dealing with the separatism, this is why we're having the problem. Yeah. We're not looking at things at a conceptual level.
It's all footwear.
Exactly.
So you shouldn't use the word shoes, but say footwear.
Yeah. I got that wrong.
Right.
Yes. So thank you very much for that, Angela, for correcting me on that. Yes. We look at it at the concept level, not what over time individual communities have been able to identify and name for themselves, which is why I'm not going to give it a name because I'm not the authority for however many billions of black/African people are across the whole globe. I'm not a messiah and I don't think I ever will be.
Why?
I am contributing because I'm not the only mind in this universe. Every mind has something positive to add. The same way this book came from inspiration from Robin Walker to James Smalls to Father Temples to Jaheim Jans, I'm just adding a piece to that discussion. Because in time, somebody will come and add some more, and then we start getting the whole picture.
Mm-hmm. So it has memory.
Oh, yes.
It contains memory.
So again, as you're drinking, if you ritualize your water drinking and even how you prepare it, you draw again on that energy. You draw on that memory. And you can make it manifest in just about everything that you need to do.
What's the strong?
Sorry.
Go on.
Leave
no,
it
I, oh, okay.
What's the strong deal for you?
What's the
word? You know what they call?
Yeah.
Only use the strong.
That comes from, again, the interaction with European. So, you know, from what I've come to know, remember what I mentioned about kava? Traditional shaman at dawn, the first liquid used for libation is dew. They would collect the dew at dawn time, and that's what was used in libation. Because that water, in a sense, appears mysteriously. And only at a certain time of the day cycle, that's what was used in libation. But again, you know, when you drink and you get spirited, sometimes you find things coming out of you. that you didn't even know were ever there. So they just, I guess, realized, ah, this thing here can push something out. So again, it's become, but as I said, most people who get deep enough and understand, push back to the water. Yeah? Because what the spirit can bring out of you, sometimes you can't always deal with it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, section might be of surprise to some. It's worthwhile mentioning that what we now generally refer to as meditation or and yoga are not only found in Hinduism, Buddhism, and other Eastern practices. There are many forms of them we still see practiced by people of African descent today. Through advances in genetic science, we have irrefutable evidence that human beings originate from Africa, meaning that most things in existence or practice have an African origin. While it can also be argued that some things may be uniquely developed within a certain context or time frame, it does not disregard the fact that inspiration is usually always drawn from other things already in existence or that came before. The landmass we now refer to as India, credited with Hinduism, is also a region that has been shown to have benefited from migrations in the past from Kush in ancient Kemet, where they created the Indus Kush civilization. In recent studies, The New Scientist 2008 clearly proves that modern-day Indians still carry the genes of their African ancestors. Furthermore, we still have the Jawara people living on the Andaman Islands who still visibly look as African today as they must have in times past, markedly different to the look typically associated with Indians today. Wayne Chandler, in his book Asian Futures, highlights this to be the result of the mixture between European colonizers and the African indigenous inhabitants. We find on the walls and papyri of Kemet visuals showing many of the poses now referred to as yoga. While we have no records in Kemet explicitly referring to them as such, it's not baseless speculation to contend they may well be of an African source, especially considering how deeply spiritual they were, like all other African communities as covered throughout this book. We must ask what purpose they could serve apart from a spiritual one. With meditation practices too, we do not have reference explicitly to the use of the breath or emptying of the mind in spiritual development as per Buddhism. Rather, we have similar practices of sitting still in silence for long periods, focusing on water in a calabash or at a flame, as a spiritual development method of learning and looking into the nature of things, as is illustrated in the Akan proverb, "Woshishe asemua unhushishe." One who looks into matter comprehends it. Both these practices in the East are associated with the cultivation of Kundalini energy to attain a certain state of spiritual euphoria. Interestingly, among the Zulu, Credo Mutua also mentions Umbilini energy, a state also achieved after periods of sitting in silence. For the Khoisan people of Southern Africa also, Umbilini energy is harnessed via a specific ritual dance. It's therefore worth mentioning these two practices in this section as they are not that far removed in nature or underlying philosophy from what we now only associate with the East, even though they exist as slight variations in contemporary practice. Their identified purpose are held to be the same, that is, for spiritual development. Yeah? So again, we see other uses for water. Yes. So there's not only just that to, in the Congo especially, where when you're dealing with that, your witchcraft, you know? Same with the water, people can see. Remember, we are water too. And you can affect people via the water and the visuals that you can bring forth in the water. Again, you're using it for harm. So when we're talking about that word, witchcraft, remember, as I said, it's only because someone is using it for something selfish. In that case, we've all practiced witchcraft before. When did someone do something bad to you and you were walking off, thinking, ah, I shouldn't do this and that to that person? You're practicing witchcraft. because those thoughts will find a way of affecting that person. So then, what's witchcraft? It's as useful as, if we can call it good craft, as the elder pepper guy said, two sides of a coin, but it's still the same coin. Can I move forward and read about the ritual? You see, so again, those who know, yeah, you have the man keep misusing it, but as we can see, it's a civilization that hasn't lasted 2,000 years, and it's crumbling. It's crumbling kind of badly. Yeah, so because it's not built on certain principles, again, you've taken pieces, but only for your benefit. Mm-hmm. So in a sense, you're working against yourself, giving me or allowing me to show that, you know, we can push past that academic barrier. So that they don't say, oh, this book is just your opinion. Where did you get all this stuff from?
Evidence, yes.
Because that's the next thing we're trying to do now, is to push you into the school system. Because the very first one, the question they keep asking us again is, so who's your reference point? Where's your reading list? Where's all of that? So we come, and we come better. So now let's see if we can find another excuse as to why we will be refused again. Yes, so thank you very much.
Oh,
yes,
beautiful. Mm-hmm.
So thank you all very much for your time and your questions. We've enjoyed them all, you know, all in here, including our brother.
Have you appreciated?
Of course. But he's demonstrated so many things for us. Most of the things we talked about, everything else. So of course we have to appreciate it. Definitely, you know. So give thanks for your presence too. Yes, and thank you all for coming.